Election Sunday to you all. Everyone dressed in their fine apparel today. You look very nice. Thank you for coming. Can we stand this morning? We want to go before the Lord and pray for the service and take up our offering. Folks, we have something very special in store for you. So hold on to your hats, hold on to your seats, and let's go for a ride. Jesus, I thank you for this day, Lord God. Thank you for what you've done for us, Lord God, at the cross, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for everything you've blessed us with, Lord Jesus, for the very air that we breathe, Lord God, for everything you've blessed us with, Lord God. Move today through this service, Lord God. Let your words touch your people, Lord God. Open our ears and our hearts, Lord God, to your word, Lord Jesus. Let it not go void, Lord Jesus. Let us take something from today, Lord God, and go out into our world, Lord Jesus, and make a difference, Lord God, and reach the people, Lord Jesus, that need to know about you. We thank you for what you're going to do, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Jesus, I ask you to touch this offering, Lord God. Bless it. Multiply it. Bless your people for it, Lord Jesus. Move upon it to further your kingdom. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, I just have a few announcements. We have a leadership meeting on the 10th, coming up in April. Yes, we have also a Friends Sunday. If you didn't notice on the doors as you came in, and there are some cards in the back somewhere, grab one. Grab a friend, bring them out. They need to know what you know. And if you don't know, you will. Let God move through you today. Because without that help, that guidance, we're nothing. We're just wandering around in circles trying to find our way in this life. It's very lonely. And it can be very scary. We have one special speaker coming up on the 17th, our Bishop Putnam. So... this man is anointed. He's got a lot of good words. And if you're not here, you're going to miss out. So show up. Come expecting. You will be blessed for it. SFC rally in Madison on the 15th. On the 16th, we have a spring cleaning day. So remember that. Put that on your calendars. It's a short time. We need to keep God's house looking nice, okay? It's only from 9 a.m. to noon, so if we all show up and get this done, we can be out of here earlier. A lot of hands make the load light, okay? Music practice on the 24th. After that, I have nothing, but God has everything. Church, let's pray. For one, for the ones that are not here, for the ones that are out sick, and mainly for Pastor. But we got someone special to take care of that for us. Jesus, I'm asking you right now to touch the people, Lord God, that have sickness on their bodies, Lord God. Move upon them, Lord Jesus. Have your way today, Lord God. Touch them, Lord Jesus. Let them feel your presence, Lord God. Move in a mighty way. And Lord, keep a hedge of protection around the ones, Lord, that are here. Touch them. Keep the sickness far from them, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you're going to do. And the church said in Jesus' name, Jesus. Amen. We have a couple other announcements, so hold on.
Bear with us. Ladies retreat. Hallelujah. Who's all going? All right. We are going to have a phenomenal time. Your money needs to be in along with your registration. Also on the 16th, I think that is, after the cleaning day, we're going to have a sewing day downstairs for the ladies. There'll be more to come. If you have a sewing machine, please bring it. This is for the ladies retreat. and we'll get some things rocking and rolling. So praise the Lord. That's all I have. Oh, I almost forgot the best part. Well, somebody very, very special to me has had a birthday, and he means the world to me. He has done a lot for the church. And he ever keeps me going. He really does. He's my better half. Well, he turned 50. I said it about on Wednesday. So after service, we'll be having cake and a little bit of treats down there. So come and join us. Relax. All right, so I have an update on Pastor. I first wanted to say thank you.
Come on, baby, it's okay.
Thank you for all of the prayers and the kind words. Obviously, they were more for Pastor than they were for us, but being able to see the thoughts and the prayers that people down on paper meant so much. So thank you for that. He arrived safely after about 15 hours flying and then another 4 to 5 hours traveling to where they are located. He did give me some pictures and some short video clips, but I'm going to keep you guys in suspense because he will have that ready for you when he gets back. He was hoping to be back the 3rd, which is next week, Sunday. He did not realize the lag time when it comes to the flight, so keep him in prayer. He will not be back until the 4th, that following Monday. So, and then we leave right away for district conference. So again, just continue to keep us in prayer. And as soon as he is back here in church with us, he will have a full report for you guys. But so far, right now, it is in the evening for them. So they have already had their services. They've had 4 services today. They had 3 in parks in open areas and 1 in a building in another town. 25 received the Holy Ghost and 19 were baptized. One of the ones that they baptized was a Muslim and is no longer. The gentleman that is working with Pastor, his name is Shampoo, as funny as that is. He oversees 79 pastors.
Wow.
And those pastors oversee, if I understood correctly, over 1,000 congregations.
Woo.
So the reach that Pastor has been able to make, that God is leading him to do, and you guys loving on him and allowing him to be gone, is you guys are reaching the world, so thank you.
God is good. You know, with all this saying, because Pastor is out there, it's as if we were out there. Because he's working on our behalf.
Right.
And everything that he's doing, he's giving God the glory for it.
Absolutely.
Church, we did come today because it is a resurrection day, for one. 2, we've come to hear what God has for us today.
Amen.
And you know what? There's no place I'd rather be.
Amen.
That bed's not going to save my soul.
That's right.
None of the stuff else out in that world's going to save me.
Right.
Except the relationship I have with God.
Amen.
And the only way to do that is to be faithful to the house of God. Listen to his word. And you know what? And hang out with you beautiful folk.
Amen.
There's nothing better than that. We will have, the Spanish will have their service downstairs after worship. And then you guys are in for a treat. So while we're here, let's worship God this morning. Let's put everything on hold because you know what? We need to worship God. Don't worry about what's in the oven or what's on the slow cooker right now. Worry about what's happening right here. In Jesus' name.
Above all powers, treasures of the earth.
Inspired.
For the children and their children too, the Holy Ghost will live inside of you. It's a promise for the children and their children too, the Holy Ghost will live inside of you. Teach you and lead you every day. He'll give you boldness and show you what to say, so you can be his witness and walk in power too. And the Holy Ghost will take the chicken out of you.
Thank you.
Good morning, boys and girls. Kinley, do you know what today is?
Stew.
Zaccaroni, do you know what Easter's about? Okay, Zach. Oh, no. JJ, I'm sorry.
Candy.
Okay, well, actually, you know what? Our adults and our youth, they've actually put on a program for us, and they're going to show us and tell us what Easter's about. We're going to take our seats.
Imagine, if you will, that you think there must be some hope. And you think that there must be some hope, but you still feel hopeless. Imagine if you were so lost, you had to find help in order to find your way home. And without that help, you would never find it.
Psalms 119, 176. I have gone astray like lost sheep. Seek your servant, for I do not forget your commandments.
Now imagine that you're a shepherd in which people like to bully. They like to make fun of you when you go into town. But when you're out on the lonely hill, watching your sheep, you shiver from the cold, dark night. Then all of a sudden, a bright ray of hope shines down on you. Angels come to you with a message of hope.
Luke 2, 10 and 11. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for I behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord."
Here's the hope: Jesus, God's only Son. But time passes, so now let us imagine that Jesus is now all grown up, and he begins to travel through your country. You hear about this Jesus, with whose God's mighty power is healing people. Now imagine that you were born blind, deaf, or that maybe you could never walk. How will you ever get to Jesus? But then, after trying to do whatever you could, Jesus comes right to where you are, and he heals you.
Matthew 15 and 30, and the large crowds came to him, bringing with them those who were lame, crippled, blind, mute, and many others, and they laid them down at his feet, and he healed them.
And now you get to hear Jesus teach. Imagine that you're right there. You can hear him speaking, but he tells you that you still might be deaf. And even though you can see, you still might be blind. And even though you are right there, you still might be lost.
Luke 19 and 10, for the Son of Man is to come to seek and to save that which was lost.
Imagine, if you will, that for hundreds of years your people have been wanting to have the perfect king to find you, to completely heal you, to fix all your problems all around you, to make sure you have a perfect home. And finally, that perfect king has arrived. Jesus has come to be our king, to save us.
John 12, 12 and 13. On the next day, much people that were come to the feast, where they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, "Hosanna! Blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord."
But now imagine, if you will, that you did not fully understand what that really meant. You thought Jesus was coming to make war against your enemies. But instead, Jesus wants to bring peace. And even though God knew this would happen, the people turned against Jesus.
Matthew 12 and 14. But the Pharisees went out and conspired against him as how they might destroy him.
Imagine feeling angry, confused, wondering what was going to happen. and you become afraid. You don't want anyone to get angry with you. You just go along with everyone else.
Matthew 27 and 22, and Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with this Jesus who you called Christ?" And they all said, "Crucify him."
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Matthew 27 and 23, and Pilate said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they kept on shouting all the more, saying, "Crucify him!
Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Imagine, if you will, Jesus being put to death, hung on a cross to die for our sins, for all our mistakes, and still we made fun of him. We yelled mean things to him, we spit at him, and then Jesus gave up his spirit. He breathed his last breath and died.
Matthew 27, 51 through 54. At that moment, the temple curtain was ripped in two, top to bottom. There was an earthquake and rocks were split in pieces. What's more, tombs were opened up and many bodies of believers asleep in their graves were raised. The captain of the guard who was with them when they saw this earthquake and everything else that happened was scared to death. And they said, "This has to be the Son of God."
Now imagine how afraid and sad you feel. You begin to wonder what this all means. You wonder, had Jesus been your only hope, but now all was lost? Well, 3 days later, there was another earthquake. You go to visit Jesus' grave, and there you see the empty tomb. An angel appears to you and gives you a message.
Matthew 28, 5 and 6. "There is nothing to fear. I know you're looking for Jesus, the one they nailed to the cross. He is not here. He was raised just as he said."
Now, even though all we can do is imagine what it must have been like to be there, we can still see with spiritual eyes. We can see for ourselves in the Bible and know that we can believe and be saved.
1 Peter 1, 8 and 9. "Whom having not seen, ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, believe yet, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls."
Imagine yourself in the worst of all possible situations. Imagine yourself as one of the disciples.
Or as one of the women who followed Jesus.
Imagine that he is no longer among you because he is dead.
You saw him die. You saw them bury him in the tomb.
There is no doubt.
There is no hope.
There is no future.
You huddled together behind a locked door, fearing that those who tortured and killed him will come and find you next. What will happen to you? To your family? To your friends?
There is no doubt.
There is no hope.
There is no future.
You heard him say when he was alive, "The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again."
But you have forgotten those words, or at least they hold no hope for you now.
The horror of the crucifixion is still fresh in your mind. You see and hear him in agony there, dying right in front of you, when there was nothing you could do.
You think about your part in all of it and wonder what you could have done differently.
You have been frightened and hiding for days, but now it is Sunday.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and to the other disciples, the one Jesus loved, and said,
"So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in.
John bends over and looks in the tomb and does not go in. Simon Peter arrives and goes right in. Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen.
Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying.
Now Mary Magdalene stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. He asked her,
Woman, why are you crying? Who are you looking for?
Thinking he was the gardener, she said,
Sir, if you have taken him away, please come with me. Mary?
Rabboni. In Amharic, the word Rabboni means teacher. Mary fell down to in front of Jesus, clasping his feet. Jesus gently helps her up to her feet as he speaks to her. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news.
Have seen the Lord.
And she told them then that he had seen what he said these things to her.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said,
Peace be with you.
After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said,
Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you.
And with that, he breathed on them and said,
Receive the Holy Spirit. If you have forgiven anyone else, then you have forgiven. If you did not forgive anyone, then you have forgiven.
Now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told them,
We have seen the Lord.
Unless I see the nail mark in his hand and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe.
A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said,
Thomas fell down to worship Jesus. Jesus raised Thomas gently to his feet as he speaks to him.
Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have seen and believe.
Jesus performs many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name.
Imagine yourself in the best of all possible situations. The Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who was dead, is now alive again.
By the power of the living God, Jesus Christ has risen from the dead and is alive forever.
The terror of yesterday is gone, and the fear of tomorrow has vanished.
Because of what Jesus did on the cross, mankind can be forgiven forever of sin.
Upon him. His perfect love cannot be
Jesus did on the cross, mankind can be forgiven of his sin.
And because he has been raised from the dead, mankind can live forever.
There is no doubt.
We have a hope.
We have a future.
God bless and happy Easter.
Forever glorified.
Cooperate sometimes, but we thank Sister Moon for orchestrating, Sister Maury, all the AV. But you know what? No matter what we do up here, the main reason we do it is because of the Lord. He has given us so much, and we can't thank Him enough. But what we can do is worship Him. And praise Him. You know, and thinking of this, God gave me something. It was, I should have thought of this a while ago, but you know what? God works wonders.
Amen.
When you're thinking about something else, He gives you something. Yeah. And it's like, man, you better write that down. So in saying that, I will let you know what God gave me last night. You notice it was about 9:45 last night. It's like, okay. Now, with all the production we did and the decorations and stuff like that, you know, well, we come expecting something from God. Some people need to know what the gospel says. And if you never pick up a Bible, how will you know?
Exactly.
If you never walk through a church door, how will you know?
Right.
You've got to hear the word of God in order to understand what God is telling you.
Yes.
Because it's all right down there in black and white.
Amen.
I know most of you have plans for this afternoon, and I won't keep you much longer.
It's all right.
I just want to extend a thanks to all those who came today.
Yes.
We do appreciate you coming here. And I pray that you came away with something from this today.
Amen.
You know what God did for us 2,000 years ago, over 2,000 years ago?
Come on.
He sent His only Son, Jesus Christ, who is God manifested in flesh,
yes,
to be our everything,
yes,
to be our protector,
mm-hmm,
our deliverer,
yes,
our father, our guide, our high priest, our provider,
yes,
our comforter.
Yes.
You guys get the drift.
He
experienced what we go through in life.
Yes, he did.
And if you don't believe it, just ask Him.
That's right.
He has everything in control. He's still on the throne.
Yes.
And in the short program was the pictograms of His birth,
yes,
to the excruciating and agonizing death that He endured on the cross.
Yes.
This is what we were supposed to endure. This is what we're supposed to have because of the sin. We were supposed to die. But you know what? Because He loved us so much, He went to the cross for us to cover our sins.
Yes.
Not only that, but He made a way for us to commune with Him at a real and spiritual level. This is where the real relationship between us and God takes place. In our hearts, in our minds. and at an altar. In your prayer closets. Because when you finally take your last breath, you will see him. Regardless of what you think, you will meet him face to face. And I pray that you will have the assurance of what he's going to tell you. That if you follow his plan of salvation, that's printed black and white in the book of life, which is the Bible. And Acts 2:38 and 39. We'll put it up there for you to read. Because this is what he gave you.
Amen.
It's all there.
Right.
It's simple. It's laid out. Once you read that and think about it and understand what it means, then you too will understand. This is what he meant. And if you're wanting a close relationship with God, I invite you to this altar. Lay it all down before him. Lay down your sins and confess it to God, because he already knows. You can't hide it from him. No matter how tricky or deceiving you think you are, we've all been down that road. We're not. We bleed. We have flesh. And we are weak. Even though we think we're strong, we're not. We need him. But you know what? He's ready for you to make that first step. And remember, he's a gentleman. He will not force anything on you. He will not pry himself into your life. He's given you a free will to make your choice. And ultimately, you want to make that right choice. Because when you do meet him, you'll want to know that you've been a good and faithful servant. Repentance for your sins is the first step. Like I said, he knows already what you've done in your life. Good, bad, indifferent. He knows. Being baptized in Jesus' name, the waters of baptism are stirring back there. They're waiting for you. If you haven't been baptized, we can arrange that. And you go down in baptism, you wash away the dirty sins and rise in a new name, and having Christ's name applied to your life.
Yes. Thank you.
And the last step is a free gift he offers to you. There's nothing you have to pay for. He's already paid the price. He's offering you the Holy Spirit to live inside you, which will help guide you in your life.
Thank you, Lord.
That's the final piece. But you know what? It's a lifelong process. It's not going to be an easy road.
Right. Sure.
But you know what? Living without him is even harder.
Yes.
But once you start that process, you'll never be the same.
Yes.
So again, I thank you for coming. And now, I do open up this altar. If you want to have that relationship with God and lay all your troubles and your sins down at the altar, and do it. Leave them there. Don't pick them up. Don't carry them out this door with you, because you know what? You can have this life-changing experience with God and a real relationship with him. In Jesus' name.